Ma ca sanct omne ad acon vecho hac eo te chigen o hei in a te madan cotan ci ap chai ble mi ci eo Ma ca se domne ad acon vecho hac eo te chigen o hei in a te mada cota ci ap chai ble mi ci eo hei
We go anywhere and people look at us, they want to say that we're Mexican. You know, and we tell them we're Native Americans. They're like, are you serious? You guys still live in teepees? You know? They act like you're not from this country. And it's really bizarre because I've never experienced that till I came here, you know?
It was obvious they thought we were Mexicans. And the guy just lashed out and said, why don't you go back to your own country? And, you know, obviously I said, I am in my own country, you know.
I used to have a vest that had Alaska on it. I used to wear it all the time because I want nobody to mix me up with anybody. But it got too small, so I had to switch to wristbands. But that's my source of identifying me, myself, you know. And this is not even Alaskan design, but it's close enough, you know, that people will know that I'm Native American.
I had became ashamed of who I was being Native American because it was stereotype that all Native Americans were alcoholics. So when I came here, people automatically thought I was Hispanic. So I agreed with everybody that that's what I was.
When I first started going to school and being the only brown person, I had a lot of people asking me what type of race I was. I always got questioned if I was Mexican, Asian, Filipino. It went through every race, and they'd never guess that I was Native American. And it usually astonished people because I had a couple of people say to me, oh, I thought they were extinct, and I didn't know how to react to that. And really it brought to me that there are only a few natives here and there in Ohio.
I'm an Athabascan from a little village in Alaska called Huslia. In the summer, we would set up a camp along the river to get fish for us and fish for our dogs. In September, every family would catch a moose, and that would be our winter supply of food. All winter would be hauling wood and trapping with the dog team. That's why we got all the fish for the winter.
I'm originally from Warm Springs, Oregon, where I grew up on the Warm Springs Indian Reservation. Our reputation there as fishermen, you know, we do a lot of salmon fishing and steelhead fishing and just following the seasons and, you know, harvesting berries and roots. And there's just ways of harvesting that we have and that have been around for, you know, I don't know, since the beginning of time for our people that we hear about.
My parents were really good about taking me to my elders to learn about things. I learned how to harvest traditional food and fish and hunt if I needed to. I was raised traditionally in a longhouse. The longhouse is where everyone gathers for funerals, weddings, root feasts, salmon feasts, huckleberry feasts. that's where they just, they hold all their ceremonies, and that's kind of the heart of where our tribe is from, our seven drum religion. Our land, our whole community used to be a safe place for us to be. We could leave our doors unlocked at night, and we could just go out all hours of the night and not worry about anything because it was safe.
It's been months since I seen a native. It's messing with my creative approach. It's got me jaded, isolated. No one understands me like my people.
And it's still there, you know, but it's barely still there also because all of our elders are dying. Our youngsters are using crystal meth and heroin, and, you know, they're committing suicide or they're committing homicide, and it's just, it's terrible.
Now, I don't think they let children in the bars, and when I lived there on the reservation, we could go in the bar, we'd go in there and we'd find my mom, and people would think it was funny that the kids were in the bar, they'd be gambling. Or they'd be playing cards. I always remember they would play three card low.
When I was 10 years old, I was introduced to alcohol, and, you know, I experienced my first drink. So, and that just kind of put a whole new spin on things there. So I think I just started the downward spiral when I was at a young age.
When alcohol came, our lifestyle changed. And that was about when the army base came in, and it was like 90 miles from our village. Before alcohol, I remember we used to have volleyball, outdoor games. All the whole village would play and have fun. And then all of a sudden it just was gone, never again. Just like it was never exist.
When I was about 15, I decided that I wanted to try to be a drinker and a user and whatever. You know, everybody in my family was addicts, so it wasn't really out of the ordinary.
I remember there was a point in time where I really hated it. You know, I hated to see the way that my family would turn out, you know, and the way that they would become as wild and violent and, you know, just, it wasn't them. You were looking at somebody different. And you would think that that's not, that I don't want to be that. I don't, and I don't like seeing them turn out like that. But, you know, in time, it's like you succumb to it, I guess, you know. You're around it so much, and pretty soon you're there.
I started leaving my daughter with my brother and my sister-in-law, and I started going out and drinking. I already knew I was being a bad mom. I already knew I was leaving my daughter and doing what my parents did. And I was just sad because I was seeing everything happen all over again on the reservation that happened to me when I was on the reservation.
I was doing what I knew how to do, was, you know, just go out and party and get wasted, you know, end up stealing cars and getting in trouble. And I got caught there for a grand theft auto. After my 5 years, 9 months, you know, I was released from the penitentiary. First thing I did was found a drink.
On the reservation, you don't just kind of drink or kind of smoke a little weed or, you know, do a few lines. And, you know, we went days on end, weeks on end, months on end. You know, it seemed like sometimes it just all kind of blurred together and it was this one long, consistent party.
I feel like for Native Americans, I don't think it's about, come on, let's go party, because I know a lot of Native Americans who drink alone. Like my dad drinks alone and he'll drink all day, but he'll just drink and go to sleep. So after I became clean, I used to think, why does he drink? What does he drink for all day and then go to sleep? So I just think, like, what happened? You know, he went to boarding school when he was real young. And I know then they used to be able to abused children in school, they seen a lot more. A lot more was taken away from them. If you were red man, you were dead man. Better off on the res, what they said, man. You a mascot,
just a ghost now. Just a thing that I wear up on my clothes now. Get all the- there was a history before all of this. You hear the boarding school era, the relocation era, the termination era, you know, the Indian Wars, you know, complete annihilation, you know, was the agenda at one point in time. Indians were deemed 3/5 a human being at one point in time, even, just to make it that much more easier to eradicate.
Every generation that's older than me put up with that and had exposure to that, whereas I had none. I had to deal with the after effect. Sitting with my mother and having her coach me in talking Navajo, it was a challenge not only for me, but for her. Any little play that I had, any little giggle that I may have laughed at myself for the way I thought I sounded, it was a challenge, because then my mom would say, "This ain't no game. What do you think's so funny? Say it right. Just say it right." And you could hear that hostility, you know, that was beaten into her for being Navajo, for speaking Navajo.
The whole era of crystal meth started taking over on the reservation, and it got scary. We started using recreational drugs pretty bad, and things started happening that we just kind of lost control of our minds and our spirits.
Leaving the reservation was really just kind of out of desperation thought that, you know, I want to try to do something different. My mom had moved out to Ohio, and you know, I called her up and I said, you know, "What you doing, Ma?" And, you know, "I'm gonna come out and visit." And I had no idea we'd come out here and be out here. And now, 18 years later, I'm out here.
I was fresh off the res when I came here, and it was odd. It was really awkward. I didn't want to be in Columbus. I couldn't wait to just go back home because it was just too much for me, you know. I wasn't used to so many different races. On the reservation, the postal workers and the doctors at the clinic were the only white people on the reservation.
You know, if I lived in the city up in Alaska for a little while, you know, even a month, it probably would have helped, but I came right from the woods to here. One day I was living in a little cabin along a lake, and our only source of food was to go catch it, and then overnight come to Columbus and just, you know, go to the store and buy it. You didn't have to look for the tracks or, you know, put a snare out to catch it.
In cities out west, there's oftentimes kind of a part of town or somewhere or somebody you can know or associate with that's Indian. That wasn't here. That wasn't here at all. And I looked at the map and I was like, there are no reservations either, you know, that's totally different.
That was pretty much like torture when I first came out, because there wasn't anybody like me. I remember crying a lot of times, and not just crying, but just that sobbing, just painful sobbing, just almost like having a nervous breakdown. Sometimes it would get so intense.
If I would have moved here by myself, I would have been like a baby out there trying to make it in this big city where you don't know anyone. There's no resources available. There's no Bureau of Indian Affairs or Indian Health Services, because these are things that are available for Native Americans in every city except Columbus and Cleveland and anywhere in Ohio.
Until my mom got involved with the Indian Center, I didn't know what it meant to be Indian. I remember being asked, like, in third grade, what tribe was I? I didn't even know. I remember, like, the first event that I ever went to at the Indian Center itself. They had the harvest dinner every year at Thanksgiving. And the first time I went, it was just amazing because this place was packed. There was nowhere to sit. All of us kids are outside. We're playing in the alley. We're playing in the backyard. And, you know, the adults are all inside and they're singing and there's food. And it was like, wow, this is, I didn't know there was this many people like me. You know, I had no idea.
When we had the center in Cleveland, it was growing up, there was Head Start, there was job placements, there was all these programs for the kids, programs for the community, where we'd gather and there would be dance class and drum practice.
Job training, employment assistance, food assistance, cultural classes, advocacy for children that were in the juvenile system.
The different cultures within the community started weaving in their own experience. It showed me that there was more to the puzzle than just being Native. There was more to the puzzle than just being Algonquin or Sioux. There was things that we needed to learn from each other. It was just Native culture that we were celebrating, not necessarily one tribe's culture. It was everybody's. Let's celebrate everybody's culture. Let's celebrate the people. It was be proud, grow your hair long, dance hard, sing loud. Those are the things that they want us to forget. Those are the things that are really important to you because that's what's going to draw them back. That's what's going to bring the people back. And being exposed to that at that time was, not to quote the commercial, but more priceless than anything that you can ever imagine.
That was a really, really neat program to have. It's so sad that it's gone. These kids, like I said, are growing up without any guidance from their elders.
One day I was looking for work, and I was looking through the yellow pages, and I looked at it, and I was like, Native American Indian Center of Central Ohio. And I was like, no, come on, what is this, you know? Is this some kind of wannabe group, or, you know, what's going on here, you know?
My husband brought home a little, suburban newspapers, and it said, that there's going to be a Native woman and her daughter singing at this church. After they stopped singing, I went up to them and I introduced myself and I met her. It was when I met Zelma and Carol. And then they told me where they were. So I would go down to their, it was just a, they call it a center, but it was just a house, a little room like this.
Selma Walker was the founder. And when she founded the Indian Center, she went door to door and she tried to find all the Indian people she could. And that's how she started the Indian Center. She had a big heart and she would just feed people. She would try to figure out how to get them gas money to get home to their reservations. She would help them get jobs and licenses, and she did everything she could to make as many people successful as she could.
Zelma and her friend Dell would talk to each other in their native language. Didn't have a clue what they were saying, but any native language besides English was was like blessing, you know, for me at the time because I missed it so much.
When I first started going to the Indian Center, they had this women's support group, And they just taught me a lot about how to be an urban Indian and learn how to be accepting of other urban Indians and their cultures, because everybody comes from different tribes.
Now, you know, a lot of us consider each other family, you know, and we talk to each other like that. We're completely different tribes, you know, completely different experiences in different parts of the country, but we still have that commonality. You know, we kind of gone through a lot of the same struggles and our same backgrounds and histories, and within our families, you know, there's a lot of similar stories.
I had went to the halfway house for 6 months, and when I got out, I felt like I was really alone, and I didn't have anybody, and I was really broken. And I didn't know where to turn, so I came here to NAICCO.
I was still into my addiction, you know, and, you know, I was still looking for highs and, you know, getting high on alcohol. And so I called in here, and I was like, yeah, man, I think I need some help, man, you know.
It was just so nice here. It was just like family. They accepted me so, they just made me comfortable and accepted us and took us in, and we spent our first Thanksgiving together.
You know, I felt like I was like, you know, it was my home, you know, it's like the people of my life, you know, like, but at this time it was different. It was like, man, you know, this is family, you know, it was like the other family I never had, people that were actually not on drugs and alcohol.
They introduced me to powwows and ceremonies and sweats, and they just showed me a whole new way of life. Because I didn't have that in Alaska. I didn't have sweats or ceremonies like that.
I started participating more into their humblishas and their sweat lodge ceremonies, and I realized all of the spiritual things that I didn't grasp onto the way I should have when I was a child.
And I always remember the first sweat I went to. I was really scared, and I think it was because of the things I've done in my life. When I got in there and it was dark, I panicked. I was scared, and I didn't want to be in there. I wanted out. So I got out the first time, and then I kept going back. You know, I started remembering things. I started feeling my grandparents close to me. And in my mind, I could feel the drums, and I could remember the powwows when I was a kid. And it was a happy place, and it made me feel good.
The ceremonies are the essence, you know, of what makes us us, you know. The ceremonies, the spirituality, the teachings, the art, the ideology, the family. It's all one and the same, you know, it all goes together. Each one's like interwoven into the next, you know, and that's Native culture. It's all together.
When it comes to health, we always look at the spiritual values first. For instance, Tashina had been diagnosed with chronic lung disease. She would have pneumonia a couple times a year until she was probably about 6. And it would be like really bad, where we'd have to take her to the hospital. When we signed all the paperwork, they never asked us our religion. They didn't have a box for Native American, you know, they had an other, but you know, even if you do put that, what does that mean to them?
Looking at the way Native affairs have been dealt with, you know, in terms of providing, you know, health and wellness to Native Americans, more times than not, it seems that it's really kind of been from the professional's point of view as to what's best for Native people. Basically, it's the outside telling the inside what's good for them.
1 year, they had her on antibiotics for like, gosh, maybe like 4 or 5 months, and nothing was happening. She wasn't getting any better. She was on steroids. She was tiny. I just decided to take her off of everything. So I talked to my dad at the time, and I said, I feel like we should just try to just take her into the sweat, like, as much as I can, and just pray for her at this point, you know. every week he would sweat with her for 3 or 4 months. And he started giving her different kind of teas made out of herbs. She just all of a sudden just quit getting sick. And then after that, she never got sick. She never had those lung problems again. They said that she wouldn't be able to function like a normal child or be able to be in sports or anything. And she's an athlete now. She's the quickest runner on her softball team, and she's a hitter. And in school, she was playing soccer and tennis and everything. So when we took her back, they couldn't even find any scar tissue in her lungs. It was amazing.
As of recently, in terms of what's been successful and what's been accepted amongst Native people, is services and programming that's specifically focused on incorporation of a cultural component, their way, their beliefs, their family involvement, their spirituality, how they live out their ceremonies. And so the slogan and the campaign currently is, it can't be about us without us. And that's what we're focused on right now. It's a community approach. And that's what Native culture is. It's family and community, tribal, if you will. And in an urban setting, it's intertribal. But that's where the success is starting to show right now.
Everything we're doing here today in NAICCO is to let people know that we're here and that we do need to have a voice in Ohio. Every other culture has a place here for them, like a lot of services, and we don't. And before I didn't, that wasn't something that I cared about or even thought about. And today it's important to me.
I drew this when I was in treatment. Those skulls represent the life that I was living and where I was going to go quickly if I didn't straighten my life out. So I look at like finding myself through like the treatment program, NAICCO and the White Bison, everything that was positive in my life, I look at that as being reborn. So I got this flower coming out from these skulls, the rose, and that's my spirit being reborn.
I always look at it now as, if anything, NAICCO is who I am today. They helped me to be who I am. They helped me to survive by putting kind of like that shawl, you know, with their friendship and their love. They just wrapped me around and just kind of like, it is powerful. It's very, very powerful.
Yeah, 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 yeah. Oh, hail, hail, we are, we are. Makase domne ada kon we cho hake o te hegen o hei ina te mada kota ke ap chai ble me chi e o hei o hei we yana e ya hai hai all hail hail hey ai we yana e ya hai hai all hail 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 Makase domne ada kon we cho ha ke o te he ke no ha he ai e na te ma da ko ta ke a cha le me chi e o ha ha o Makase domne ada kon we cho ha ke o te he ke no ha he ai e na te ma da ko ta ke a cha le me chi e o ha ya ra ya ya o ha ha we ai we ya ra Makase domne ada kon we cho ha ke o te he ke no ha he ai e na te ma da ko ta ke a cha le me chi e o ha ha ha